You are listening to The Sexual Life.
Hey, what is happening, guys? This is a TSL podcast bonus. And here we are in my room. We're getting kind of casual here with this setup. But this is with Damien, Dieke, and I from the School of Attraction. Definitely look him up. He actually recorded this. There were some audio problems, probably on my part. We were using software that I wasn't familiar with. And man, as a result, Damien sounds great. I sound like shit. But I've done everything I could to bring that audio up. But that all being said, we're talking about something really important. We're talking about something that a lot of people bullshit about here in the men's development industry, and that's open relationships, polyamory, swinging, all this crap, which is, it's not crap, it's actually awesome. You should do it. I want you to do it, but I want you to do it right. I want you to hear the truth about it, and not some bullshit thing that just sounds cool, looks cool, so you could be marketed to as desperate guys. But I want you to know the richness of having a sexual life. So that's what we were talking about. We actually did this on January 7th, 2017. So just a couple days ago, it's the 11th that I'm releasing this. And man, it's great stuff. Damien and I both talk about it. He gives away some bonuses. You can find those bonuses at School of Attraction. And a great guy, great coach, can help you out with many things beyond social dynamics and life and so on. And then I give away a bonus in this, and you can find that at thesexuallife.com. That's the Instant Connection course. It's what I've been giving away for the past, few episodes at least. And you guys will really get a lot out of it. That all being said, guys, let me just say this. The TSL podcast, we're going to change it up. I'm going to start another podcast so that can focus on the men's development stuff. Because I want the TSL podcast to be about sex. I want it to be about what we started with Bang Radio and all that sort of good stuff. In any case, let's get into this awesome discussion. If you have 50 minutes, listen to it all. It will help you out so much with understanding relationships, yourself, and sex, and all the great benefits from that. All right, let's get into it.
Hello, guys. It's Damien here from School of Attraction. And I've got the guest that we've got tonight is, he's actually one of my favorite guys to talk to. He and I have, we've met in person probably about three times in our life, and always at the 21 convention, always in a foreign exotic city. And every time we meet, we have these incredible conversations. So I'm genuinely looking forward to having this conversation with him today. The man is Steve Mayeda. He is the founder of The Sexual Life, and of course, he's the host of the awesome 21 convention. Steve, how you doing, buddy?
What's up, man? How's it going? Yeah, Damien, good guy too. Obviously, you guys follow him, so you know that.
Cool, guys. So, what sort of prompted this? I mean, I talked to Steve, a couple of months ago, and I said to him, I really want to have a chat to you, but I want to talk about something that's really interesting that we're both fascinated about, and I know we have a lot of common ground. And Steve mentioned that he'd recently been sort of exploring open relationships and monogamy with his partner, and it had been really complicated and it really messed him up in some ways. And I was like, whoa, I have been through this. I've gone through a lot exploring this world of monogamy and open relationships, and I'm like, we have to talk about this with the guys, because the reality and the practice, it's so different, right?
Dude, I did an interview yesterday, and I was telling the person, like, look, I just liked sex. When it came to like pickup and seduction and all these different things that men come to, because it's like, that's why we're here. It was like, I want to do everything. I wanted to do every single thing. And all I had done before that was fail, get some success with women, have relationships in the most traditional sense that I could imagine, even though they were kind of crazy. So when I got some skills, it was like, I wanted to do everything. That meant everything. That meant open relationships, of course. That meant swinging. That meant living with multiple people. That meant all this sort of stuff. And immediately it was like, this is crazy. And it's a lot of work. And I don't know if this is true, but one time my friend told me the symbol in Chinese for trouble, I could totally be getting this wrong, but just go with the metaphor, is the symbol of two women standing under one house. And so it was like, that was so true. It was like, this is crazy. This is insane, man. This is like all the problems of one woman get multiplied. And so even though there's two women now, it's not just two women. It's like there's more. There's just more intensity behind it. And I was like, this is crazy. So when this was early on in my whole, 2007 or 8 or whatever. And I was like, really looking, how could I get this? And I turned to the fellow coaches in the pickup world, and I really realized that they hadn't done this, you know, or they had dated two girls at once and not told them and stuff like that. And it was just, there wasn't a lot of experience there. And so I really had to like look at outside of that industry and look at it myself. And, there's so much to the world of sex. You got to try it all to really get the definition of what it is. And I think that's my main message of it. But my second main message would be that all these ideas like monogamy, polyamory, swinging, being celibate, these are all man-made concepts to deal with our sex drive and how we interact with people. And we're going to get them wrong. But it doesn't mean that they're wrong. They're an attempt at our expression. And the expression is right. And the expression comes from us, our sex drive, our emotions, and all that good stuff. So really, you know, that's really the main point that I'd like to make, is that there isn't a right or wrong. It's really that these are all just attempts to try and fulfill us socially and sexually. And maybe we should look at that fulfillment. Where are we getting that wrong?
Yeah, it's interesting because the journey for me, it started a while ago. I mean, it started with, because anyone who knows me knows that I'm a proficient reader, not just I really read an exorbitant amount of consume information. And you know, I'd read a lot of materials Sex at Dawn and other books that sort of discuss the concept of human monogamy and what is right. And I think you're onto something important there, that right or normal or I don't know, special human behavior is complicated. Because everywhere I'd look, right? I mean, every bit of research, if you look at like human morphology, for example, the way we're shaped, there's great evidence to suggest we're not supposed to be monogamous, and there's great evidence to suggest that we should be monogamous. When you look at our genetic code, you see great evidence to suggest we're supposed to be monogamous, great evidence to suggest we're not. When you look at our hormonal balance, right, we have the vasopressin and the other bonding hormones that make us monogamous, but we have the way our testosterone cycles work and everything suggest that we're supposed to be not monogamous. And the reality is, the deeper we look, and it doesn't matter what field of science or research one does, it keeps coming up that humans aren't really one or the other. And what makes things even more complex is, you know, when we look at primates, when we look at different types of primates, we realize that complex animals, especially complex primates, often have multiple complex mating strategies, meaning odds are there is no right. There is no this is correct for humans, and it's probably humans are so complex emotionally, physically, socially, that they are capable of engaging in many different types of sexual, romantic, relationship-based engagement, absolute one correct thing. And that's where I started this journey from, was that mindset of, holy shit, what's right for me then, and how do I find that?
You know, it's interesting, like, I'm not in all a scientist, and I don't, like, try and be any of that, but one of the things that I've, like, looked into and just kind of tried to understand it, right, is that when you look at neuroscience stuff, I looked at that for my last 21 convention speech about addiction and trying to just get past the, like, oh, it's dopamine, the neurotransmitter, like, I really did my best to break down areas of the brain a little bit better, but again, not a scientist. But the interesting thing is that our as mammals, we need to live in a community, so that's just a mammal thing. But as human beings, what makes us pair bond is much more than most other animals and most other mammals. So as mammals, we got to live in a community, and that's important. You know, we'll pack up, we'll be influenced by one another. And that's very, very important. But then also as mammals, we're one of the three that has sex for pleasure. And so that means culturally, it's going to be part of our language. Our sexual behavior is going to somehow build into our identity of who we are and how we interact. And the other thing is that our part of our sexual dance is that we do pair bond. So another thing about monogamy is this is some interesting stuff, and is that you're going to feel it. If you're sexually active and you're having good sex, you're going to feel the urge. You will hands down feel the urge in your life that you want to connect to that person, and you'll feel that you want to connect with them for the rest of your life, forever, in that moment. And that may last a day. It may last a couple seconds. It may last just until you come. It may last, you know, for months. It may last for years. But that feeling, in order for it to sustain past months, it needs to, it needs to evolve into more than just that feeling. So the early feelings of that pair bonding, of that love, of whatever you want to call it, that urge to connect and to be with that other person, right, is going to last a short time, right? Even though it feels like forever, and you're going to have to work at other things to make it work. And here's the interesting thing, right, is when we're not feeling that, when we're not emotionally connecting with people, when we're, you know, we could be being social, we could even be being sexual, but not fully connecting emotionally, or we've made the choice because we've had some pain in relationships to be single, then we see that as totally illogical. And we go, man, that doesn't make sense. I don't want to do that. So when you think about this in your sex life, and I know this for my sex life and everybody else's sex life, you're going to wear many, many different masks that are all a representation of you, right? They're not fake. And one's going to say, I want to be with this person. Another one's going to say, I want to fuck everything in the room. Another one's going to say, I just want to be alone. I don't want to have any sex. Another one's going to say, I want to have, you know, experimental sex. And I think that that's the best way to look at human relationships, is that to take pride in that rather than when we feel monogamous or we feel like we're swinging, to feel shame around that. That doesn't do anybody any good.
Yeah, I think that masks thing, that triggered something for me. And the thing that it triggered for me was one of the difficulties. I suppose in a minute, I mean, I would like to share our experiences because I think our personal experiences are useful for the guys. But before we do, I think that because for me, my difficulty was also something would happen because everything you're doing is out of the ordinary. Once you engage in an open relationship and start to engage in that dialogue, everything you're doing is, it's socially, you're breaking a lot of social rules that you've grown up with and been told this is how it is. Your mom and dad told you this is how it is. Disney told you this is how it is. And all of a sudden you're experiencing things that aren't, that are outside of that, that you've grown up being told if this happens, something's broken. So I really struggle with that. Like I would have an emotion myself and I would think, shit, I'm thinking about this girl that is my partner. What does that mean? Does that mean my relationship is broken? And it's even worse if your partner's having feelings about someone else, which is inevitable too in an open relationship, right? I mean, these sex and emotions are not separate things. It doesn't matter if you're a dude or a girl. What does that mean? Because it's really easy to tell yourself that story that you grew up with, you know, and it's really hard to take those masks off and be willing to just be whatever and let someone else be whatever's natural to them too. I found that ridiculously hard. I felt like my partner should be what she's supposed to be, like in my head, what she's supposed to be rather than whatever she is. I find that really hard to do myself and even harder to allow someone else to do who I loved.
And anything that is giving you a rule, I mean, so when you look at this, like rules come from society, culture, religion, all these different movements within society and culture. When anybody's telling you what to do, you're not being yourself. Now, as in the learning process of anything, especially a behavior like socializing and sex, which are two separate things that come at two separate times in your life. In fact, like your sexual brain doesn't stop changing until, what is it, like your early 30s or something. So there's so many different like ways that you move, you know, and you change and different ideas happen. So like the early 20s you is very different than the early 30s you, let alone the early 20s you with a sex drive is very different than the early 30s you with a sex drive and so on. So we change a lot as that happens. But that all being said, like, think about the social movements, the political beliefs, the just ideas and ideals that you had when you were 15, you know, and think about that when you were 20. And then think about how that ties into sex. And think about how that ties into trying to figure out when you got dumped by your girlfriend, or when you realized how powerful your sex was, or how powerful your dick was, or whatever it is, right? Think about that brain in that moment. And they're two very different things. So the experience with what you have in you, man, it's tough. And then the other thing with that is we need the guidelines to follow. We need that to follow. But at the same time, we need to know that our experience is the greatest thing. So if I believe in, I'm 20 and I believe that having a girlfriend is the right thing and being honest and just going in and never lying and trying that out and having it not work, well, so what? That doesn't mean that I need to abandon my ideas. You know, and in my early 20s, it was totally like, fuck this, you know, whatever. But it means that I got experience, and that experience is going to show and guide me who I am. You know, that's the biggest thing. So I need some training wheels. But when I take those training wheels off and I fall, it's not the bicycle's fault. It's not the path's fault. I may need to get on another path, but it's me on the bike. You know, and that's the relationship that I'm trying to build.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. And I'm thinking, actually, as I hear you, if I put myself into the shoes of 26-year-old Damien, who hadn't really been through this path yet, I'm 33 now, I wouldn't have understood what's so complicated about this. Like, why? Like, it was hard for me to understand. It's an open relationship. You just try it, and if it doesn't work, you move on. I mean, it's simple, but it's not simple, and it's never simple. And there's a lot to be learned. I think for an open relationship, there's a headspace that both parties need to be in, and there's this understanding. And yeah, you're right. I mean, you really do. Whatever I think I know now is going to be totally different in 5 years. And that's, I've learned that. I've had to be very humble and learn that the hard way, that lesson.
Yeah. Another thing that I'd say is when you see like sex defined by groups now, like let's say if women need to look too much towards a way to define their sex, or if men need to look too much to a way to define their sex, you really get totally detached to where you're not even having sex and you're no longer an expression of yourself. And I think that causes a lot of damage.
Yeah. Yeah, it does. Gosh, yes. Yeah. I mean, that's almost a different conversation when you're talking about sex has to be you and not what you think it ought to be. You have to, right. But that's like this, yeah. Totally other, yeah, beast. Yeah, yeah. I think.
I kind of cut myself off there because I sensed that you were going to switch to a different. I cut you off, but anyway.
Oh, good. But what I was going to say is, yeah, I was going to go from that. I was going to say, I would you be willing to share a bit of your story? Because I think, I mean, I'm happy to share some of mine as well to give you guys an insight into what, because I guess we often present ourselves as experts, as people who have a clue what we're talking about. But very often we go through emotional shit too. And that's willingness to go through that as part of how we've learned some important lessons. So I think it'd be great for the guys to hear a little bit about our stories if you'd be willing to share.
Yeah, sure. I mean, like in terms of, so I've like had lots of experience with dating multiple women and living with multiple women, and I don't do that now. And that's not because I'm against it. I think every guy should do it. I think that every guy should do whatever you want and to figure out what you like. And I know a lot of people who've lived successfully in many different ways, but I definitely know less people, far less people who've lived successfully in open relationships, because it's a lot of work. So, I mean, man, there's been times where I'm going to brush through this really quick, and then I'll get to like more personal stuff, because that's what's actually on my mind and easier to talk about. But I mean, man, there were times where I had multiple girlfriends that lived separately from them. There were times where I would stay in the same house with two girls that I was active with. And that caused a lot of problems. That, I mean, I remember watching the show Big Love, which was about polygamy, and the guy was telling his son, the polygamist father figure was telling his son, he said, you know, in order to have this life, it's a lot of work. It's a lot of responsibility. It's a lot of you being a man. And Jesus Christ, that's very, very true. Whereas everybody is like the benefits and worshiping and sexual whatever. Man, whatever. Like you can do that as a single man much easier, you know, hooking up with people if that's your goal. There's also been times where I've had relationships where we've had open relationships, and the relationship I had before this one went on for 5 years, and it was amazing. It changed my life. In fact, I was at this place because I had so much sex from, I forget what it was, like 2006 to 2008, just like so many partners. And just got caught in this like kind of PUA headspace where you're with one person, but you forget, or like you're dating one girl in California, but you think she likes it in the way that a girl in Dallas likes it. And you get them all mixed up and your sex life becomes so just bizarre. And it truly for me became about something else. I mean, I was at a high sex drive, but it was not about the like I had to limit the benefits of sex and the experience of sex in order to be having that sort of output of sex. Like I was really having sex as somebody else and not myself. Because it's like more and more, more and more. Oh man, count the lays. It was very important. And that behavior isn't necessarily bad. The behavior that's bad is not being yourself in the moment. So, that all being said, I was like, man, did I even enjoy sex? You know, so I was like, you know, 30 at the time. And I was like, I when I was 26 and I dated that girl for a really long time, I think it was just in my head or I was misinterpreting things. I didn't really like sex. Like, because I don't even like it. I have the urge to do it, but it's not enjoyable for me. I really thought that. And so I met this other girl and I spent 10 days with her. I was teaching a workshop and then I met her. And then after the workshop, I spent 10 days with her and all we did was have sex. And it was like amazing. And I loved it. And we fell in love and it was awesome, right? And we stayed together and we were long distance for a while. And sometimes I'd go over there and sometimes she'd come over here. And there were times where I'd date other people. There were times when, you know, we decided on being monogamous and then I'd cheat on her and so on. And there were times when I would be monogamous with her. I tried all these different things. You know, I'd have girlfriends that I wouldn't sleep with. And it was crazy. But it was, to me, it was worth it because she was such a great woman. I mean, she was such a great woman in so many ways. Not only did she show me to enjoy sex again, but there's so much good stuff about her. Well, the interesting thing is in that 5 years, I probably slept with like 100 chicks. She was only with 3. And there were a lot of times where we were open. And the other thing too is when everybody's sexuality is different. Not all guys are like this, but when she would hook up with another person, it turned me on. It also made me jealous, but it like turned me on more. So it was like this big thing and like, you know, got me all into it. And then it took the experience that she had away from her, because for me, it was like, oh my God, this is like awesome. Tell me about it. And like, I'd get all into that shit, right? Some guys are into that, some guys aren't. But then it would also make me jealous. So then after the fact, you know, a day later, another side of me would creep in and it would fuck with me. And, you know, like pickup and men's development and all this stuff says, like, you got to control the frame. You've got to be strong, which none of these guys have really done this. You know, none of these guys have really lived this life. And if they do, it's all for sensationalism. And it's not for the reality of like guys actually living a better life. How you listening to this, you know, can go like, all right, how can I be a better man while having the sex drive that I have? Nobody's said, or people aren't saying that message, you know, which is really sad. They're saying like, oh, well, fuck chicks because you have a sex drive and you're a man. And I do that. And I live with, you know, 5 girls and they all worship me because you would probably want to be worshipped by a woman. It just plays so much to just BS, right? And nobody's telling that real story. So for me, again, I was all alone. I remember I'd call people and I'd talk to a few guys, Hypnotica and John Lichtenberg or Zan, who all said, hey, we don't always do this. You know, and it takes a lot of work and it's a pain in the ass. And I would talk to my other friends who actually, you know, may have experimented with this. And they're like, yeah, it's awesome. It's great. It's super cool. And they talk about their unique quirks of when they were swinging or whatever it was that was there. In any case, what happened is towards the end of our relationship, we were fighting a lot for many reasons. You know, people fight for all sorts of reasons. I think just not having good sex is not an excuse to end a relationship if you're really committed. You know, I mean, if you're just whatever, you know, you could pick and choose all these things. But if you're really committed, you know, we were together 5 years and it's like the orchestration of things really messed with us. So what happened is she was like, well, I want to see what things are like. In fact, I think it was me encouraging it, because one thing that happens in relationships, but I've lived a lot of stuff. This is some like more street stuff for you out there. But if you tell a girl what to do, If you're afraid of a girl leaving you, and you want her to stay and you want to control and do it in kind of an asshole-y way. And I never did this with her. I did this with other girls that I wasn't as deep with. Encourage them to sleep with other people. It's like, well, go do it. I mean, go do it. See what you think and do whatever. And you make the choice. You do whatever you want. They'll do it. They get carried away. And I just know this from having, because like I said, I was with like 100 other girls in that 5-year time. And so with them, I'd be like, well, man, go fuck somebody else. I don't care. And I really didn't care. But then they'd be like, oh, will you let me, man? Is it like he fucked me so good, but I got to come back to you. They always come back. It's like crazy, right? It's like the most amazing thing you can do. So I did that with her. I did this with my girlfriend that I cared about like a lot. And so she did it and she felt bad about it. But I did it really like forcefully, like aggressively. You know, I was like, well, do it, man. You say you don't care. Like I was mad, you know, you're done with this relationship or whatever. Well, go do whatever you want then. You know, it's like, do it, man. You're so smart, you know, type thing. Totally wrong move. And I remember talking to one of the guys in my mastermind group at the time, and he was like, you should just get out of the relationship, man. You're doing like pimp stuff with her, and this is your fucking, you know, your love. You shouldn't do that. So anyway, that was it, like 4.5 years. Well, it took about 6 months for us to totally implode after that. And it sucks. And it was for the best for both of us. But when I got in a relationship again, so I got out of the relationship. I'm like, I don't want to be in a relationship. I'm just going to get laid. I got on like a lot of the online stuff, just did a ton of like, it's so easy to get laid off of those. And just because I bought Damien's Tinder app. Actually, Tinder wasn't around when I was doing this. But, no, man, it just got bored. And then I met a girl that kind of swept me off my feet. And I was like, wow, this is crazy. Maybe I could have a girlfriend again. I don't know. And it's crazy because she was like, I'm not ready for this. And then I met shortly after that, just because my mind was, wow, maybe I could have a girlfriend again. You know, it's been about 6 months, which is not long. And I'm like, I don't know, you know? And then I met Maria, and it was like instant. And I remember once we realized that we were really in love, it was like, hey, I want to be with you and I don't want to be with anybody else. I don't want to play any of that shit. And she was like, me neither. And she's a really sexually experienced person. Now in that relationship, you know, we've been together almost 5 years now. We've done a little bit of experimentation, and her rule is if she doesn't want me sleeping with anybody, she'll get too jealous. And that's always been the rule. So I haven't. But for a couple of years, I was like, you can do whatever you want. And like I said, I have that thing where I'll get turned on by it too, but it also make me like jealous and pissed off as well. And like all women with this, they don't, like if you allow it or if you like open the door, now with this, it wasn't like forceful, but they don't do it much. I mean, she only went to experiment once. And in a way, like, you know, she immediately didn't like it. And then when we got in a big fight a couple months back, like a really big fight, she talked about how much that actually affected her, and it bugged her. Now, in the moment, maybe not, or all those different things, but the way sex and relationships and emotions sit with somebody over time, dude, it's so different. So, that kind of gets me almost to present day. I mean, I haven't talked about a lot of the stuff that's happened more currently with Maria and I, and I can get into it, but I want to see if you want to say anything too, because I've been talking for a while.
Well, good, man. You tell a good story. It's I'm sitting here nodding my head. I'm like, yeah. I guess, yeah, it was interesting. My pickup days have gone wild, were like 2005, 2006, 2008, 2009 as well. So it was kind of, we're both going at the same time at different parts of the world. And that was a really crazy period. And it was interesting that, you know, I met my current partner, Divya, in 2009. And when we met, we were both like, just so you know, I think you're hot and I get along with you, but I don't want a relationship. Which is like, yeah, I'm here in the same space. So let's just have fun. Let's, you know, hang out. But this relationship shit ain't happening. But she was an incredible woman, and we had some such amazing talks that we had that chat too. And we said, you know what, I've done all this crazy stuff, Because I'd never done an open relationship in the past. I'd sort of done the whole, you're seeing one girl and then you go and pick up another girl together and, you know, all that kind of stuff. But that's not an open relationship. That's just fucking, you know, multiple girls, right? Yeah. It's just being single. And so anyway, as our relationship started, we were really monogamous and it was an interesting experience for me. But we agreed that, and she really fostered this in a strong way. And this was confronting and powerful for me at the same time. And she said, I want a relationship where, and I think you do too, and you don't realize it, where we share everything that we're thinking. Like, we're not assholes about it, but we actually are willing to. I think most problems in relationships happen when you think things that you think are wrong and don't matter, so you don't say them, you know? And I want to have a relationship where everything is shared, all thoughts and feelings are shared, so that even while it's difficult, you always know where you stand. And this became really interesting when it came to other people, because, you know, I would say to her, you know, I am feeling feelings for this girl. And it's kind of bugging me a little bit. What are you thinking about this? And she would say the same thing to me. You know, she'd say, I'm feeling feelings for this guy. I like you and I don't want to ruin the relationship just for this feeling, but this feeling's here. And it was really interesting that, and it was a big lesson for me. And I think this is a lesson for not just open relationships, but any relationships. I think that there's something powerful that I felt, because in the past, as a younger guy, if I felt these urges, I would not know what to do with them and they'd fester, you know, because they weren't being talked about, and anything that gets repressed just fucking explodes internally, right? And it was really interesting that sharing with her, having this dialogue, which was, I'm having these feelings or she's having these feelings and we talk about them, it's like a venting process. They'd vent the gas, and then the thought of being with that other person wasn't so significant anymore, because it wasn't bubbling up and being all sort of confined. And that was amazing. But it also led us down this journey of realizing that, hey, I think it's actually quite normal that a lot of people would be in a relationship and want to do things with other people, because I'm not necessarily an abnormal human being and you're not necessarily an abnormal human being. We're just being honest with each other, and people cheat so often, but here we are being honest and saying that we want to be monogamous, which we do, but we both kind of feel like we want to be with other people too. And, you know, you got this thing in relationships, and this could be good timing? Was it Lewis? Louis? I can't remember. But someone was saying he was thinking about being in an open relationship. The problem is that in a relationship, you can't possibly keep making that other person feel special and sexy forever. Like, that is a really tough fucking gig, year after year after year. And so you want to feel like the man, and women want to feel like she's this sexual, you know, sexually exciting thing. And it's really hard to make your partner continue to feel that. And my partner, Devere, and I, we thought, all right, well, maybe it is actually healthiest to sleep with other people and, I guess get to feel these feelings and bring that excitement home to our partner. You know, normally what a lot of people do, and then the statistics bear this out, a lot of people just go and cheat on their partner, don't tell them about it, and use that as a way to kind of maintain excitement in the relationship and all this kind of crazy shit. And so we thought, but if we do it openly, this should be, maybe this is healthy, maybe this is the natural thing to do. And it was interesting because I'd never felt any insecurity in relationships before. But when this whole thing started, I was going insane, like in my head, just the thought of her being with another guy, the threat of another man being around, that the threat of her being interested in another guy, like it drove me insane. Yeah. Like, it really fucked with my shit. And I didn't know, I mean, it took me a long time to really understand it. And I think that in my personal experience, obviously I can't talk for everyone because everyone's going to be different, but for me, it was a couple of things at play. The insecurity itself was like a byproduct of other stuff going around. And one of the big factors at play, funnily enough, I'd never thought about myself in this way, but for me, it was about control. I couldn't control, like, I had done so much pickup that I'd learned to control social situations. I could control conversations. I could control outcomes. I could read people. But if she's out with another man doing stuff, I can't control the emotional journey she's going to go through. And all of a sudden, I was, I had no control. There's nothing I could do but just sit back and go, well, fuck. And I was really unaccustomed to that. I'd learned to really dig control. And I think control is a really big deal for a lot of guys. Like a lot of shit that guys pull, like that the men that I work with, a lot of it actually comes down to control. I want to be able to control if she'll message me back. And you can't control if a girl would message you or if a girl wants to go on a date with you. You can't control shit. You can influence it. You could be a charming motherfucker and hope, but you can't control anything. And if you try to get too comfortable with the concept of control, life will serve you a really tough lesson. And that was the lesson that I was learning at that point. But the other lesson and the other part to this, actually, and I think as we talk about open relationships and whether they're healthy and whether they're good for people to do, is that actually my partner, Divya, she was getting into it for some of the wrong reasons. And she didn't know this herself. I mean, this is, she was being as honest as she knew how. But what, one of the things that was resonating with me was something didn't feel right about around her motivations for wanting an open relationship. And that was sort of, I was picking that up on a subconscious level. So for her, she had met me when she was 20 years old and had never really done, had a chance to be a sexual woman outside of like with me and to play and be silly and be crazy. I mean, we met, we started a company together and it became successful and we became business people. And, but she never really got to be stupid and young because, you know, she, just her childhood and everything else, she never got that. And so she was actually trying to escape and actually have romances with other people and engage in this stuff you usually do when you're in your early 20s. And she didn't get to do because we met when she was so young. And so that was her thing. And I was picking up on that. And I think that one of the things I've learned, and I've talked to a lot of men about my experience, is I think that you have to be certain in an open relationship if that's really what you want. And you've got to be certain it's really what your partner wants. One thing, when we went to swingers clubs, my partner and I, we met a lot of couples where the dude's there and the woman's like, oh, it's his birthday. And I thought he'd like this because it's something he's always wanted. And I was, I would cringe because the woman didn't really want to be there and she feels so uncomfortable. And I just wanted to hug her. I didn't want to have sex with this woman. I just want to hug her, you know, I mean, like, it's okay. It's just a thing that he's got to go through. So, you know, you both have got to want it, but I think you've also both got to be in the right headspace. And it's very possible for men and or women to get to want an open relationship for unhealthy reasons, because of shit you haven't dealt with. So when I was, Steven, I could understand that idea of fucking lots of women and going nuts, but it not making you any happier. I can really relate to that because I reached a point, you know, yeah, where I'm going out and I have like 3 or 4 girls a week. It's ridiculous. And I realized that oftentimes I'm not even looking forward to sleeping with them or having them over. It's like, but I have this sense of duty to myself that I should do it because I wanted this for so long. And I should do it because I'm a man and that's what men do and that's what I've trained for. And all the wrong reasons to be having sex with people, as well as to feel better about myself, because sex is a drug like any other. So, if, you know, I think that it's important to understand why you want an open relationship and why your partner would want an open relationship. Because if something isn't sitting right there, if you've got emotional shit that's undealt with, emotional, I mean, open relationships are likely to bring that to bear. And you're going to have a hell to deal with if you haven't dealt with your own emotional crap when you engage in an open relationship with someone you really love and you're really connected with, not someone you just kind of hypothetically you're with. It doesn't really count, at least in the concept of what I'm talking about here. But yeah, I think that's a big thing for me of what I have learned from my experience so far.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny because probably a lot of guys want to hear like, what are the tips and tricks to, you know, open relationship? And there are, you know, I mean, you have to be, you got to have rules. You know, the pussy's got to own the dick or the dick's got to own the pussy. That's the crude way of saying it. But one of you has to really be like, to be able to guide it. You know, it's great if both of you can do it, but statistics are that's not going to happen. So you have to be able to communicate. Also, you'll get more out of freedom than you will out of control. But so what I mean by that is like, you know, it's like, hey, well, do what you want, make it a choice. Because it always should be me. Now, here's the thing. A lot of times we try and control that, you know? And so like I was saying with my ex-girlfriend, I tried to control that because I knew she'd come back. And then there's the other thing too. It's like, well, if I am setting down the rules, that's an element of control. Rules are really a boundary that you put around so that people can, you know, work within. There's so much stuff that comes in with it. And then the other thing too, this is an interesting little, I guess, secret you could say, is that when I talk to men who've had affairs or that have had open relationships, and when I talk to women who've had affairs or had open relationships, they all say the same thing. Well, no, they say two things. One that I hear from a lot of the guys is that, wow, it made me like my partner more. So even if they're cheating and they get past the guilt of that, they're like, God, now my sex life is reinvigorated. So there's something about that diversity that helps. The interesting thing is that second thing is there's a lot of people who feel guilty and then they don't have that. And then they secretly, they do like it, but they're not open with it and honest with it. It just gets all crazy. So that's so interesting. You know, if you have sexual variety, it brings you back to what you, it alleviates the sexual tension or maybe the other tensions that you're having with your main partner. And it allows things to come back up to the surface. It's really kind of an interesting thing.
No, I was going to say, I think that's very true. It's amazing how you get perspective from that. I think it's very human to want to feel like, as a man, you want to feel like the man, and often picking up women, how women see you is how you get to feel like the man. So you do seek that, especially if, I mean, a lot of guys aren't in our position where we really got good at the pickup stuff. And then a lot of guys have never been had a chance to feel like the man. And I think that's actually dangerous. Yeah. That's where midlife crises and that stuff comes from. And women usually get a chance to feel like the sexy, attractive, you know, goddess sexually. They get to feel that in their lives and that's great. But everyone wants to keep feeling that and revisiting that. And I think that's it's this crucial human need. I think, you know, I heard you talked about rules. And that triggered another part of my experience that I would like to share, which was that I learned that rules are bad. And I think in relationships, rules are bad. I think that's a big, that's again, it was part of my control thing. But I'll tell you why I think it, my theory, and I'm interested to see what you think, Stephen, is that rules are, when we are given rules, we often, we want to break them, B, we want to fight against it, and C, no rule is really like absolute, and no, every rule has exceptions and it's totally messy. Yeah. And what I've learned, and I learned this from open relationships, and I think this is important in an open relationship, was that you don't have a rule. You have a, this is what I want. This is what I feel like I need. And this is the boundaries that I feel like I'd have. Like, I feel like if you did this, it wouldn't be okay. And that it's not a rule. So you can do the way that I'm saying this is what I want and need. You do what you want and need as well, but with a knowledge of what I need. And if you break that, if you do something that doesn't work for me, tell me about it and we'll talk about it. I don't know how that will impact our relationship, but it's something that I don't like.
Yeah. And go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, and I feel like that was really powerful, because the second you had that, the second it wasn't a rule, the second it was like, my partner doesn't want me to do this, whatever this is, this act, it doesn't even have to do with women or monogamy or other, you know, people. But the second it's not a rule, it's just a, this is what my partner really wants. I can break it if I like. It's not like, you broke the cardinal rule, you're a dead man. It's, oh, I don't like this and I feel really hurt about it. I'm having horrible feelings. It might, you know, the second it's not a rule, somehow I felt more compelled to work with it. And if I felt like I wanted to do something outside of what she said she felt comfortable with, I was way more likely to talk to her about it first. And the same was the other way around. And I think setting rules actually sets you up to have really a lot of difficulties, because rules will be, your boundaries will be pushed in any relationship. And if you call them rules, you're suddenly stuck in this weird position of, I'm supposed to break up with you, aren't I? But I don't want to. But you've broken a rule. Aren't I supposed to lay down the justice? God damn it. Yeah. What am I supposed to do here?
Rules and boundaries. So, I mean, first off, basically what I was saying is that somebody's got to wear the pants.
Yeah.
And that could be, maybe you wear the pants in this area of the relationship, she wears the pants in this area, whatever. But, I mean, it's got to happen. But rules, I mean, I'm the least structured person in the world. And when you see people enforce hardcore rules, it's when they don't know. And when I don't know something, I put a rule down. So if I don't know how to get in shape, I put a rule down on how to eat and get in shape. But then eventually it becomes my expression, where I'm going to want to go to the gym and eat properly on my own. But the rules are there when we don't know, or when our behavior needs to be, you know, trained or whatever you want to call it into a certain particular deal. But hey, there's a few things because we're running out of time, right? I want to say a couple things. So my most important things that I've learned in all of this is that relationships are going to happen in your life and you have to be prepared for them. And they're going to be in all different things. And I think it's important to talk to men who are experienced in relationships and not just men who've read a lot about them. When I mean experienced, like I want to talk to men who've had kids. I want to talk to men who are, you know, grandparents. I want to talk to men who've been married, who've been divorced, who've experienced or have that around you. Because I'll tell you this, when, you know, I'm 39 now, and maybe it's because of my age, I wonder about this stuff, is that my brain has calmed down so much, for better and for worse. But when Maria and I had problems a couple months back and we were breaking up, it was very clear to me that I wanted to be with her and that was it. And when you're in desperate modes and in pain, you think a lot of stupid shit, but that was very clear that I wanted that. And when I turned to a lot of guys who had experience in life that were actually a part of my groups, which is super cool, and not coaches, you know, because there's a lot of coaches who haven't had the experience, right?
Amen.
I mean, how many other guys who do what we do actually have had a girlfriend? You know, I mean, it's like there's very few that have for a long period of time. And when it is, it's like about control and status. It's so terrible. But in any case, these guys, what they said was like, look, you know, there's a certain pride and masculinity to knowing what you want and not having to look at what other people say you're supposed to have, you know, like the men's movement or whatever, and knowing what your emotions are and fighting for that and saying that you want it and you changing for that and you changing for somebody else. We always hear that that's such a point of weakness. But the thing is the only people I know that do that, that hold on to like the image, and we got to hold on to the image. We got to hold on to the rule. When we don't know, we need the rule and the boundary, right? But once we find out who we are, we have to go, okay, I'm willing to do this. And I remember talking to this guy, Mike, and he said, no, fuck that, man. Fight for your family. Fight for what you believe in. Fight for that. And if you walk away from that at the end of the day, who cares if you said, I'm sorry in this conversation? Who cares for 6 months if you felt a little bit weak because of whatever? Because you got to hold on to something that you believe in and who you are. Whereas everybody else is saying, that might hurt me. I'm going to have a bigger middle finger than everybody else. And it was just so amazing. You know, another guy, Rick, he was like, look, you know, you got to do what you got to do, but you're not trusting the healing process. You think pain is too much, you know? And so these are like things that we as men need to hear. And the best piece of advice that I got is a guy, Doc, and this guy, Mike, and they actually said, well, first it came down to this. All women want in a relationship, is to be cherished and to feel secured. And if you can do those things, it alleviates so much tension. But what a man wants is he wants to be believed in. And if she can show that, it'll alleviate a lot of tension. Those are two big things. And one thing that Doc told me is he's like, okay, let's take that into consideration. Your woman right now is mad at you. She doesn't want to talk to you. She fucking hates you, right? And he's like, how about you just go in, because you go in, you try and talk to her, you explain yourself, it pisses her off. Why don't you just go in and just listen and just go in and say, well, for my own feedback or whatever, I just want to hear your side of things, not argue, which is very hard to do, by the way, and just hear what happens and just hear it. He's like, when you do that, the stuff comes out. And then the only thing left is the love that's always been there. And that's what happens. You know, in order for that decision to go, okay, let's work this out, that's what happened. You know, such a beautiful thing. Whereas, what else do you hear from most men? No, force her, break her, win. She needs to realize she's a woman. She's a, whatever. Hey, you know, I'll tell you this. I've done that stuff probably better than any of you out there. And I've broken a lot of women. I've made it. I've owned them in whatever ways. You know, all that sort of shit, right, that people say. And so many people preaching that thing and they don't even do it right. And I don't want that. You know, I realize that, and if you want that, that's cool. But do it right, at least. You know, to all the Reddit red pill motherfuckers out there. Like, fucking do it. Don't fucking write about it. Do it for real. I did it for real, man. I still have women coming to me this day who, I'm amazed. Like, why would you talk? Like, but because you have that impact. But I didn't want that. What I wanted was a choice. A person to make a personal choice with their expression, their emotion to want me and to love me and to make that decision for today that I was the best man for them. That's a better feeling to have, and that's what I'm looking for. And I think that's what a lot of men are looking for. And the road to that is in a straight line. Really, the road to that is going to come from you just reading something and get out, interact with men, be a part of a community, and build this dialogue so that, you know, I can come to you, because that's what I did. I went to my group that I built up over the last 10 years, you know, and got advice from those guys. So that I think is very important about this whole thing. Open relationships, closed, monogamy, swinging. You gotta express yourself and realize when you get lost on that road that you can have a place to turn to.
Yeah, actually, I want to second that. I think the sign that was hugely powerful for me was a men's group. Was having a men's group to go to. That was a group of men who would be honest and go, dude, she's trying to fuck with you. Dude, you're trying to fuck with her. Or dude, you're fucking with yourself. But to call me on that shit, because it's really hard to see forest through the trees when you're really struggling. You know, and yeah, having a men's group, look up, like find a men's group in your area. And yeah, exactly what you said, man. I mean, I only have insight to give because I've fucked up, you know, and live to tell a tale and learn from it. You know, and that's the only way. And I can't tell you the absolute perfect outcome, but I can tell you what I've learned and the important lessons that I've pulled away. And of course, you know, I know you're the same. No one is a guru in anything. They're just someone who's fucked up a lot and has some good, you know, advice to give as a result. You know, something else, just one other thing, because there's some good bonuses that I want to give you guys to sort of say thanks for, just reward you for being here. But before they do that, I just want to say, by the way, is there anyone or any material you think it would be great for guys to read? I know someone called Dan Savage. He's written some amazing stuff on, like, really real shit on open relationships. He's got a term that he calls monogamish, which is this idea of, you know, most people want to be monogamous, but there's an ish factor to almost every human being, and how do you deal with that? And he's written some really amazing stuff on that. So definitely look him up. I don't know if there's anyone else you'd recommend just on that topic, Steve.
Man, I haven't thought about it. I mean, like I would say, you know, if you want to talk about relationships and open relationships, I would say join Austin Men's Development. Talk to Doc. Talk to a lot of the guys in my groups. That's what I do. Mm-hmm. In terms of like what you could get out in of a publication, man, I don't know. Coaches, I'd recommend. Hypnotica, John Lichtenberg. John Lichtenberg is a pretty amazing guy if you haven't heard of him. You know, Zam, obviously yourself. But these are all people who've like done this, right? This isn't like, you know, somebody who's conceptualized it or just done it a few times. Or like, man, there's a guy that's a coach that talks about living with these chicks. And it's like, man, the guy's had like two fucking relationships in his life. And he's really popular and all this stuff. But it's like, the message that I hear from like a John Lichtenberg or a Damien is much different. It's much more real, and it's not so dependent upon what's going to market well to people and what desperate guys are going to want. And that's very important, you know? So I would say like, and I'm not a big reader. So, you know, you're a big reader. You look at all that stuff. I can't read it all, man. But, So I like listening to people, talking to people, and building communities. So, you know, there's a lot of guys that I know that I turn to in my own groups that are just great. And then of coaches, you know, there's a lot of the guys that I'll talk to.
Cool. Anywhere where guys can get this stuff is amazing. This is kind of a topic where I just like to keep talking. But we can't do that because I think we'll be here for 3 hours and guys are like, shit, I'm getting hungry, motherfucker. You know, as you guys have seen some of my other talks know, every time I interview someone amazing, I always want to make sure that we give We've got something amazing to give away to you guys. I love men who take action. You're my favorite kind of men. I can relate. I'm an action taker. Steve's an action taker. Stephen, there's a really awesome course that you've got that you're offering to the viewers. You want to tell them about that?
Yeah, so there's the Instant Connection course. This is a social dynamics course. And perhaps I should have added some stuff on relationships too. We have those too. But it's called the Instant Connection course. It's a four-part video series. And this will basically, very thorough videos. I say, you can go over it all in 4 hours, but I say take 2 weeks. To really digest it all. But what it will do is teach you how to meet somebody, be totally normal, be yourself, build a connection, build structured conversation. So you do learn some rules to have your conversations flow by so that you can let go of those rules and truly be yourself and build deep connections with people. Like you should be able to do it like within 2-3 minutes after that. And then also how to get sexual, make the conversation not just about being friends or end up in the friend zone, but to state intent and be that guy. So to meet people, build conversations, and to build a really intense connection and to show that sexual intent is all in there. And it's all broken down over video, as well as you can download the slide PDFs to it and so on, so you could read, the different dialogue templates. It's really good. It's a great first step for guys just wanting to express themselves. And I'll tell you this, like, even if you're not into the whole social dynamics thing, you're like, well, my priority is not to go pick up chicks. Learn this because there's guys in my courses who've made like $20 million sales using the rapport techniques in this. So, I mean, it's if you're a salesman, if you're out talking to people, if you're somebody that wants to build connections with the deepest part of somebody, it's a really good course for that. And the exact stuff that, two of my friends, they're salesmen. I don't do this. They do it. But they all tell me, they're like, well, I have these opportunities in my life. It's just that I did the exact same thing to get intense rapport with people. And he showed me their emails like, man, I've never had a guy talk to me the way that you did in my 20 years of finance banking. This is insane. I only want to do business with you. It's crazy. So this course breaks that down, and it's good stuff.
That's really awesome, man. I'm gonna have a watch myself. I'll double the rapport thing. Maybe they're similar. I'm really curious to see, but in part of the offer that guys can get through me as well is a rapport process. But I agree that if you can connect with someone really effectively, like in a really deep level, really quickly, that is not just about women. That is a life skill that every human being needs to have. So, yeah, that sounds amazing. I'm definitely going to grab it myself. As for my end, guys, it's kind of like a double barrel. It's I know a lot of guys want quick wins. If you're here like a single guy, the first item that you get when you sign up is going to be, it's basically a bunch of 50 changes that you need to make to a Tinder profile, because we've just launched a whole Tinder training program. And Tinder is really easy to crack and get incredible results out of without a lot of social skills. To just start lining up dates is really effective. So they're going to be getting that straight away. And then from that, you can actually get access to my Sincere Seduction book, which is the complete sort of step-by-step guide about creating really like high quality intimate relationships with what I call high quality women who have their heads in the right spaces. This is not about manipulating or playing games with people. It's about being a very real, confident, genuine version of yourself, but being able to attract amazing women that way. So, grab at that, guys, because we sell a lot of copies of that, and you guys are getting that for free because you're here in person. And these are two amazing packages. Take advantage of it. Take action while the iron's hot. Steve, buddy, thank you so much for being here. I know the guys watching just, I know that they appreciate the shit out of you taking the time to talk to them here.
Yeah, no problem, man. Thanks for allowing this format and forum. It's a good one. I haven't done it, so it's pretty cool to do it and maybe even implement it myself because it's so
cool, man. And guys, you guys, you men watching, I have respect like nothing else for you men who are here on this journey challenging this stuff. Most men just go day by day, like in quiet desperation and not willing to challenge themselves. And you men, you're the special men. So I just much respect.
Awesome. Yeah. Thank you guys so much. We'll see you guys.
Cheers, guys. See you later.
All right. Cool. We are done, at least with that bonus episode. Guys, we got some cool episodes coming up. Episode 142, 143, 144, 145 all have to do with some crazy sex stuff that is going to just be awesome. If you're listening on iTunes, follow us on YouTube. If you're watching this on YouTube, follow us on iTunes and Stitcher, and of course Stitcher. You guys get the story. But we're doing good stuff here. Follow us. I'm putting out good content for you guys. And if you have questions about, requests for content, thesexuallife.com. And of course, the Austin Men's Development Board is the thing to do. It's just such a great men's group. We talk about it in here. Yeah, it's free. It's badass. And it is. We'll talk to you guys later. Thank you so much for watching.